Hello, Malty Mouth Moisteners. Ralfy here with Ralfy Review 747. And a big thank you to Lord Arthur X, or K, Arthur K, for that malt mention. Right. Now, I did say in my last whiskey review here in the Manx Bothy, somewhere in the Irish Sea, that if about 25 or so people, excuse me a second, oh, that's better. If about 25 people asked me to review the 4-year-old heavily peated Bunnahabhain from the Good Spirits Company in Glasgow, I would. On the last count, about 36 of you had asked for a request, so here we go with the review. Now, there's two things you need to know before I even start with the descriptors. As you've probably noticed, I'm still stuck with a cold, so I haven't been able to do much in the way of nosing of this whiskey. Most of my comments will actually be to do with the tasting of this whiskey, because my taste sensation is reasonably intact. In fact, my taste buds, my taste tongue sensation could not avoid the sheer brute force of this single malt event. More about that in a minute. And secondly, the other thing you need to know is that this whiskey's now sold out. And when you have single cask limited bottlings in small individual specialist whiskey shops, the reason they're there is that the proprietors of the shops have a good rapport with the whiskey reps from different companies who are coming in to sell them whiskey. So when the shop proprietors ask the whiskey reps if they can sell them a barrel of whiskey to put in their own label, it makes sense in terms of a business decision for these bottlers and whiskey sellers to provide a cask, because it's building up a good rapport with the shop that's selling on to members of the public, the customers, occasionally known as consumers, if you happen to be following the marketing spins. But in this instance, because the shop knows that their customers are adventurous and are not the same people who are shopping in travel retail, for example, are buying off the shelves of supermarkets where the discounts are, then they can be braver in what they bottle. And that's certainly what's happened here. As a result of which, the regular customers, they know that the bottling's probably going to be quite good. They certainly know that the price isn't inflated, and they know it's going to be worth a risk. So as soon as someone buys a bottle, or five or six people have bought a bottle, they want the tasting bragging rights on social media, whether it be Twitter, Instagram, or WhatsApp, or Facebook, or whatever. And then quickly word travels, so that a few folk will phone a shop, ask for the whiskey to be put aside for them to collect, and they'll pay it over the phone using the card details. And that's increasingly the way whiskey is being sold. And something I'll touch on in a future video is the morphing way that people are buying whiskey, because it has changed a lot from even 10, 15 years ago. In the meantime, this is 4 year old. Yes, 4 year old single malt steampunker. So I can tell you the gory details. It says distilled at Bunnahabhain Distillery. What it doesn't tell you is that this, in fact, is a very heavily peated version of Bunnahabhain, which is known in trade circles under another name called Stoisha. There we go. A little bit of inside information for you. So that you will frequently see barrels of whiskey which are actually under a different name, but that's the sort of in-between name. It means that perhaps the bottler can use the distillery's name in the final product, or maybe they can't. So you may see Highland Park bottled as an independent bottling of Highland Park, or just called Orkney, which is the generic name for Highland Park as an independent bottling. You see, and now who said everything was going to be straightforward? So this is 4 years old, 270 bottles in total, and bottled at, you're going to love this, 59.2%. So we're just literally a kick in the ass of 60% alcohol, which is 50% extra alcoholic strength. Does it need water? You bet it does. But first of all, I mean, smell it. Heavily peated, raisins and Bunnahabhain. I'll leave it at that because I'm not smelling much else at the moment and I don't want to get creative about it. So taste wise, wish me luck. I should hold my nose for this, but there's no need at the moment. Oh, I'll be with you in a minute. Oh. This gives Cask Strength Laphroaig a serious run for its money. If you're the sort of person who likes to be beaten up by peat, you're going to love this. One spoonful from the silver spoon. Two. Loads of water. Lots of water. To taste this neat is like tasting the solution of smoked fish, smoked raisins, peat bonfires, hot chimneys, hot stones by a seashore with salt on it. It's just, frankly, bonkers. The bite on the palate is enormous. I'll leave it at that because the first impact, I mean, I know fine well that anybody who has a bottle of this, you're going to take not just a tiny wee drop of it neat, you're really going to take quite a swig simply to get beaten up by the peat. You will not be disappointed. Hopefully you will not require hospitalisation. I think what you basically, make sure you've got a big glass of water on standby to help you recover after the first taste of this. Here we go again. Already the Scotch mist is starting to appear in the glass. That's better. It's all about the peat. The sultanas in there, it's a little bit of red fruit. There is a young, blunt Bunnahabhain character, but the whole event is driven by an enormous overblanket of slightly twiggy bonfire smoke peat fusion, which you might recognise from some really old Bowmores, that kind of chimney smoke effect. But this is just a perfect example of how Bunnahabhain, which comes from Islay, but we don't generally consider to be a particularly peated whisky. In fact, there are versions that are unpeated. But when it comes to putting huge dollops of peat in it, it really does work. This is 4 years old. This is interesting because, by the way, I can feel my nose clearing up beautifully at the moment. I think I've discovered an additional cold cure. once you tame it down, it's so elemental and overwhelmingly about the arrival, development, it's all as one. There's no separation. It's just not even a sherried peat bomb. It's not even that. It's just pure peat whammy. That's it. What would I give this? It's very young, clean tasting. For those who are into peated whiskey, it's an absolute, this style of whiskey is an absolute must. I'm going to come to that shortly. I'll give this 84 out of 100. It's a malt mark. However, in fairness, if you are a total peat monster person, I'd have to give it 90 just for the volume, the loudness, the choke slam impact of the peat itself. But we'll stay at 84. I've got to be objective and consistent and just stick to the one malt mark. Now, the reason that the peat event is so interesting with this whiskey is simply that it's only 4 years old. So it's got past the first 3 years of life, and you can imagine that the raw British spirit, the cleric as they call it, it's gone into a reasonably active cask. That's natural colour. So you've got some decent colour for only 4 years. So it's been into a decently active cask. Bourbon cask? That's about as near as... It's hard to tell, to be honest. It really is hard to tell. But 270 bottles out of one cask, a cask strength, it's probably a hogshead. So they could have taken out of a butt. They could have half-emptied a sherry butt. You know, there are options. But at only 4 years old, the rawness of the phenolic impact in the new make spirit has barely had any time to subside, mellow off, or be broken down by the activity of the cask in maturation. The result is that you get something which is short, sharp, and huge in its effect in the palate, but there's nothing sophisticated about it. But that actual elemental nature of the event becomes its success. It becomes what's so enjoyable about it. And importantly, for many peat fans, you're getting an angle of experience and smelling and tasting peat single malts, which is very rare at 4 years old. At which point you can then go to a non-age statement whiskey, peated whiskey, and with the experience of having something which has identified and delivered the integrity of on the label of declaring an age statement, you have a point of reference so that you can know whether you're tasting through the mouthfeel, through the points of reference of identifying young, spirity, immature single malt. You can either taste it or not taste it in the non-age statement whiskey and then know just what you're paying for. And this is really quite important because there's increasing numbers of non-age statement whiskies out there, and with producers withholding the information that empowers you to know what you're smelling and tasting, having the option of frankly more exciting bottlings, which they're harder to find, but every distillery worth its salt anywhere in the world really wants to be thinking about producing this. And I conclude by saying, and I'll come back to this again, all distillers who are going to whiskey festivals, the people who go to whiskey festivals, who buy the ticket, who want to taste and get to know your product, they're not just the occasional wanderers through travel retail. They're not just people going in at seasonal holidays in the new year to get a bottle of what's the cheapest single malt I can get off the supermarket shelf. These are people who spend a lot of money on whiskey. That's why they can be bothered going to whiskey festivals and visiting distilleries. So please, distillers, don't just try and fob off these valuable, important customers by having just another generic brand, at times, a boring brand, unexciting brand, sitting on your table. Because see, at the end of the whiskey festival, you'll still have a lot of that whiskey sitting in the bottle. And it's the whiskey festival's goers' way of telling you that that's not what they paid their ticket to taste. Now, I hope you distillers are going to take note of this. I'm trying to help you here. Because sometimes, distillers, you don't help yourselves. And I'm being honest. Distillers, have a bottle of your new make spirit that never went into a cask. Your clear, white, off the still spirit. Have that on your table at shows so people can smell it and taste it to get their bearings. Have something really young, spirit driven, that may not be for sale, but you can easily go and get a duty free sample for purposes, for trade show purposes, out of the cask. This is what people want to taste. Then have your timeline. Your 4-year-old, your 8-year-old, your 12-year-old, your 16, your 21, so that when people are getting to know in detail your still signature, what makes your single malt, they have this range of options, which they may not necessarily be able to buy, but by the end of the show, by the end of the whiskey festival, you look at what bottles are empty and what bottles aren't, and that is telling you what you should be bottling next. It's not rocket science. I'm Ralfy, here to help. I'll be back again shortly with Ralfy Review 747 Extras, in which I will be explaining why I made an enormous blooper in my last Ralfy Review 746 about the Campbelltown malt. Oh, it's going to be interesting. Join me shortly. Bye-bye.